Welcome to Tanakh Talk. I'm your host, William Hall, broadcasting to you live out of Kingston, Texas, USA, with a brand new series for you, Exploring Isaiah with Rabbi Tovia Singer from the island of Coffee, Jakarta, Indonesia. Rabbi Tovia Singer, welcome to the show today. It's good to have you. And very, very excited about this new series we have going on here. This is really great. Great idea, and can't wait to just go through the entire Tanakh with you as time permits and Hashem permits. So welcome to this pilot program, and I'm ready. I'm excited for it, Rabbi.
I'm sure many are. It's great to be with you. It's very exciting to explore the book of Isaiah together, and this is the first in a series of broadcasts where we're going to go through the book of Isaiah very carefully. And I should just mention this part just to begin with. I have, over the years, I've had many dear friends who very bright, very sharp, well-trained, and they sought to go through Scripture, the Jewish Bible, and they would go through the book of, you know, obviously through the Torah, and what are called the early prophets, like Joshua, and Judges, and Samuel, and Kings, and they would go through it, and they would work it through, and they'd be fine. And then when they get to the book of Isaiah, when they would approach the book of Isaiah, within one or two chapters, they would completely collapse. They would just completely fall apart. And it was very, very challenging for them. And the reason for this, as you will see in a moment, is that whereas the Torah and the earlier prophets are run in a basic narrative where there is a basic chronology that generally dictates which chapter follows the next. And while there are exceptions to it, there is a principle that in fact the Torah, there isn't a definite set chronology, but it basically runs along a specific chronology. The books of what are today called the latter prophets, those are 15 books, they don't follow any chronology at all. That means that when you look at books like, let's say, the three major works of what are called the latter prophets, specifically Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel, there isn't even an attempt to follow any sort of chronological order. Chronology does not dictate which chapters follow the next. Isaiah is completely arranged in a completely different order. What guides a book like Isaiah is completely theological, and it's there for instruction. It's the same thing with Jeremiah, and the same principle with the book of Ezekiel. They're completely out of order, and therefore those who expect to read Isaiah chapter 1 and presume that they're reading somehow the early part of Isaiah's extensive prophetic career, so they're going to be in for a huge shock in that Isaiah, even the first chapter, is not the first thing that happens. This, by the way, in contrast to the book of Jeremiah and Ezekiel, at least their opening chapter is, in fact, the first event in their prophetic career. Jeremiah, Ezekiel, they're called upon, Ezekiel with its famous ecstatic vision of the divine chariot. At least Jeremiah and Ezekiel start off with the opening chapter is in fact the beginning of their prophetic oracle. Isaiah's chapter 1 is not the first chapter of Isaiah in chronological order. In fact, the earliest part of the book of Isaiah is chapter 6, which is very, very famous. That's one of the many, many reasons why the book of Isaiah, for many people, is very hard to tackle. because they're expecting to read something like the five books of Moses. Now, I've done programs. We've gone through the five books of Moses, and generally they follow some chronological order. There are some very striking exceptions, but there is a basic chronological order. Certainly, if you get to Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings, there is some. When you get to Isaiah, there is no chronological order. Jeremiah is completely all over. You can have a chapter here that's connected to, you know, chapter 7, chapter 26, they're connected. Chapters all the way at the end of Jeremiah are really in the beginning of Jeremiah. It's all over the place because, now for some people when they first approach this, this could be a very frightening prospect. And that's why some people close down, literally just go into a shutdown mode when they hit the book of Isaiah, because what they expect, and in fact, there's no genre like this literature that's contemporaneous, they simply just shut down when they get to the book of Isaiah. So it's particularly exciting to be able to begin to launch this program, this series with you, William, where we explore the book of Isaiah and followed by other books in scripture.
I know that there's a lot of, definitely a lot of controversial things, I think in chapter one even, you know, and I know you'll cover all of it, but that I've been hearing over the years where, you know, God despises the sacrifices and the new moons and he hates this stuff. And, of course, my comprehension of it changed pretty much right away once I kind of got started thinking outside the box and started thinking outside of the mainstream Christianity and such. And I was very pleased to just dabble into it. So now we're taking it one step further from dabbling into diving, which is your main profession. So this ought to be great and full of beautiful detail. And so,
it is very exciting. There is a flip side to this point, which I think most people miss. And that is that there is, in a sense, Isaiah, in a very important way, and I think in the most valuable way, is easier to study than Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings. You go, how is that possible? I just finished telling you it's completely out of order. The reason why, in a way, it's easier to understand this is we are looking at the Word of God. It means we're not looking at history books. Very often people look to the Bible like they're reading a history book that God happens to be talking in the history book. This is a huge, huge mistake. This is a sophomoric approach, which people often do because they're not familiar with the text. So they're going, what do you mean? How come? How is it possible? What do you mean it's out of order? How could this be? But actually, it makes Isaiah, in a sense, easier to study because what are called the Nevi'im Rishonim, the earlier prophets, because they are filled with gripping stories, gripping events, a record of events that occurred, and they are all shocking and riveting and powerful, and it is so easy to get caught up in the story that you actually forget that you're reading the Word of God. More specifically, when reading the book of Samuel, as an example, and the reason I say Samuel versus Samuel 1 and 2 is originally that was one book, and Book of Kings 1 and 2 really is one book. What happens is that the books are so gripping and the storyline does follow a narrative that you just forget you're reading the Word of God, and most importantly, you totally miss what is the prophetic message. Like, why am I reading? Why is this the Bible? Why is it Scripture? Great, it happened, but why am I hearing about this? Why is this so important? Do I really have to hear about this crisis in the book of Judges? Not just one, but one after the other after the other. What is being conveyed here? So what happens is that when reading earlier prophets, there is a great danger in that, but it's completely different. The danger is you think you're reading history. And then the Word of God, the spiritual message that one is to derive from this is lost completely, because you think you're reading a story, a very powerful, gripping story. The thing about what happens when you're reading the book of Isaiah, when you're reading Jeremiah, is that it is impossible to read this text as simply story. Yes, there are, Isaiah is going to record histories throughout, but as I said, it's completely out of order. I will explain why. There is other guiding principles that dictate the order of chapters of the book of Isaiah. Why isn't chapter 6 in the beginning of Isaiah if chronologically it is first? We'll deal with that in a moment. But when you're reading Isaiah, you're getting pounded with prophecy. When you're going through these chapters, these epic passages in Isaiah, there's no way in the world you're going to be seduced into this idea that you're reading, you know, Barbara Tuchman, you know, that you're reading some sort of historian or some sort of gripping story about the ancient world, which we are not familiar with, and thank God for Isaiah, that now we know what happened. In fact, Isaiah is completely tied in to Kings, to Samuel, to Chronicles, and we'll be tying those in together as we go through the book of Isaiah. But what makes Isaiah easier, in a sense, what makes Jeremiah easier, in a sense, and Ezekiel certainly very much like this, is that you can't read Ezekiel, you can't read Isaiah, and not know that you are being splashed with prophecy, with the word of Hashem. Because that's all that's coming through. It's so clear that way. But you can be seduced with the earlier prophets into thinking, oh, this is a great story, and it's puzzling. How did King David do that? How did he make these changes? But you almost ignore that because the story is great. The story is so gripping. I should say one other point. Some people think that Isaiah, of the three large prophetic works in the latter prophets, Isaiah is the largest because it has the most numerous chapters. That, in fact, is not the case. Isaiah does have more chapters in the book of Jeremiah, but Jeremiah, by far, is larger than the book of Isaiah. So although Isaiah has 66 chapters and Jeremiah has 52, so one would think, well, Isaiah must be much bigger than Jeremiah. In fact, Isaiah's chapters are smaller than Jeremiah. Jeremiah is much, much larger than the book of Isaiah. And Ezekiel actually is slightly longer, although it only has 48 chapters, but they're massive chapters. Another introductory point to the book of Isaiah, and that is that if you go to a university setting and you study about the book of Isaiah, some liberal commentary on Isaiah, or whatever university you take biblical studies, if it's not a religious institution, if it's not a yeshiva, if it's not a place that they fear God, you can be absolutely sure that you're going to be told that the book of Isaiah was written by more than one author. This is very important. The reason is very simple. You're going to be told, no question. I've been at conferences where they gather scholars in from different parts of the world, and so people then come together, and then they hear different speakers teaching. And sometimes it's not my time to teach and I'm off, and I'll sit in on somebody else's class, and I'll sit into some professor from whether Cambridge or whatever, and they will just go, Isaiah was written by three authors, at least. They'll just say that right off the bat. Question is why? What would compel them to say that? And the answer is very simple, and that is that in the secular world, Isaiah presents a monumental problem. Because they do read Isaiah, as they read all the Bible, without God in it. What I mean is that they don't a priori, when they come to the book of Isaiah, they a priori, they believe that Isaiah is a completely human book. They might use it. It's spiritual, it's inspired, all kinds of fancy jargon. But if you ask straight away, some liberal whatever, did God convey his message to Isaiah? They'll say no. This raises a monumental problem for the secular world, for the academic world, in that Isaiah very clearly in chapter 44, verse 28, 45, verse 1, that's where the chapter breaks, so they continue, describes an event of Cyrus, who was the king of Persia, who called for the building of the second temple and for the Jews to return to Jerusalem. Isaiah lived more than 150 years before Cyrus. And therefore, because the secular or so-called the academic world completely reject the notion that the Bible is the word of God, they cannot have, it is impossible for them to have Isaiah, one author who lived roughly 2,730 years ago. So let's say, just I'll get down to the chronology of Isaiah and when Isaiah lived. It's actually extremely important to understanding the book of Isaiah. You can't even understand unless you understand when it was written. You'll understand in a moment. But let's say Isaiah was written from around the year 750 BCE to 700 BCE. Let's just say that, okay? All of Isaiah was written roughly 2,750 years ago, then this has to be the word of God, because there's no way in the world that Isaiah could have known about Cyrus, who was not even born yet. Isaiah lived during the Assyrian Empire, during its emergence of the Assyrian Empire. He had an enormous prophetic career that spanned a tremendous amount of time and a very critical time. Isaiah saw one of the greatest moments in Jewish history, and that is the king Uzziahu, who reigned at the time the longest, for 52 years. Later would be someone else by the time, and a fantastic king, his son Yotam. This is like one of the greatest periods in Jewish history, and we'll learn in a moment why. It's critical. You cannot possibly understand the book of Isaiah unless you understand what role these kings played. And he also would see the destruction of the northern kingdom. He would see the 10 northern tribes being shattered and destroyed by Assyria during the reign of Hezekiah, to the point that only Jerusalem was saved. And the most striking miracle that God performed for the Jewish people during following the Exodus. Incidentally, much of the events described, almost everything described in Isaiah, is we have given the period we're talking about, this is the ancient world, we have a considerable amount of archaeological material, scripts that have been dug up that conform exactly to the prophecies. So Isaiah in the secular world is discussed as it had to be written by multiple authors. You had to have one author who could have written 1 through 39. Why? Because the original Isaiah couldn't possibly know about Cyrus. And then what you do is, it's very simple, you have to engineer it. And then you have to have another author who actually wrote from chapter 40 through 55. And when we get there, we'll explain. And another one from 56 all the way to 66. You have to have it. This way, your problem solved. Because who wrote about Cyrus? It wasn't really Isaiah. It's really a forgery. It was written by a later author who lived after the fact and wrote about Cyrus looking backward. And then it was clipped on to the earlier part of Isaiah, as though it's all one book. Now, there are two kinds of secular, the two kinds of professors I've seen on this subject. Some of them will admit this, and some of them won't. I have never done a survey of who will admit it or won't. So some will try to present this as though, no, there's some sort of literary reason why we can see that Isaiah was written by more than one author. The more honest secular academic scholars will concede this right off the bat. I've been impressed. I didn't think, but I've sat in on enough, like, again, when I've been at these conferences where you have scholars from around the world, and I've sat in on some of their classes on Isaiah, because, you know, let's say I have two courses that I'm giving that day. from the morning till night. So I have the whole day. So after I lunch, I can do what I want, right? There's a professor from some campus in Houston. I'll sit in on the class. I wanted to see what's going on. But I was surprised to see that many of them just concede this point. It's incidentally the same reason why in the secular world they say that the Book of Daniel was never written during the Babylonian Empire. Why? The reason is because Daniel was completely cognizant of the Greek Empire and he couldn't possibly know about it. So they have to shove Daniel later and place him around the time of Hanukkah. And this way he can look back and he can know about the Greek Empire. He can know about Alexander the Great's death at a relatively young age, and then the split of the Greek Empire. So that's what the secular world does. They come in with a certain bias, a religious bias, or a lack of religious bias, and then they overlay that bias onto the text. Christians will do that as well, and we're going to learn about that as we explore the book of Isaiah together. I want to also, as we go to Isaiah, it is extremely important for me to lay out one other point about the breakdown of the Jewish Bible. Most people know that, your show is called Tanakh Talk, and what kind of an odd word is Tanakh? Well, Tanakh is an acronym for the three major sections of the Jewish scriptures, of the Hebrew Bible. And that is the first. So Tanakh is an acronym that stands for Torah, and that's the five books of Moses called the Pentateuch. And then you have a second section called the Nevi'im, which means the prophets. And then you have the final section, it's called the Ketuvim, the writings. Now the question is, why is the Jewish scripture divided into three parts? And what is even more perplexing is, why is there a part called the writings? Because the writings were all written by prophets. So, for example, Jeremiah also wrote Lamentations. The book of Jeremiah is in the prophetic part. The book of Lamentations is in the writing section. Why are these divided in such a way? Because the writings were written all by prophets. They weren't written by secular Jewish writers later on and so on. So it's very important just to understand this point. That is, the Torah is the five books of Moses. Torah literally means teachings, and it tells us how to live our lives. It's an instruction manual that guides us how to interact with God. So that's the Torah. That's the teachings. The Nevi'im essentially contain, there are no new commandments in the prophetic work. There's no 614th commandment in the prophets. But the prophets contain every mistake you can possibly make. I mean, given that you have a Torah, so now there are a lot of errors that a person can make. They can misapprehend what's really important, what your priorities should be, mistakes that you can make, how you can mess up, and how you can fall deep into sin. That's what the prophet's all about. In fact, if there isn't a problem going on, the prophets will almost certainly ignore it. The prophets are very interested in what errors occurred in history and to point to those mistakes. And that's where the ketuvim come in. The writings, which for instance include the book of Psalms, the wisdom literature, like the book of Proverbs, book of Job, it tells us how to get back to God, how to make it right. So the Torah tells us how to live our lives. The Nevi'im, the prophets, are essentially of what you can do wrong. The prophets also contain an enormous amount of messianic prophecy, which is important, and I think most viewers of this show presume that the messianic prophecy is there to give hope, and it is certainly there. Many people see the prophets when they look at the Nevi'im as, okay, it's basically about Jews, this is what you've done horribly wrong, God's going to punish you, but it's going to be good, and I'm going to comfort you at the end, and you'll have a messianic age. Don't just read it that way. That's a mistake. The messianic prophecies are not there just to tell us about something that will happen in the future, although that's true. But the messianic prophecies are there to tell us what the world should look like at any given time in history. They were, when Isaiah preached the messianic prophecies, they hadn't yet occurred. They would occur in the future. His generation would not see it. For example, prior to the carrying away the 10 northern tribes, you couldn't have a prophecy in Isaiah 43 of bringing back those who have been taken away. It didn't even happen yet. So the messianic prophecies contained, not just in Isaiah, but in other works of the prophets, are there to tell us this is what the world should look like at any given time. Nations should not lift up sword against nation. 10 Gentiles should come to the Jew and say, teach us about God, because now we know God is with you. That's very, very critical. The ketuvim are there to tell us how do you get back to the Torah? How do you bring it home? And that's what's very important. There is a strange thing I can tell you, and that is the term latter prophets about these 15 books is a misnomer. I think most people, when they think of latter prophets, what do they think of? They think of later prophets. That means somehow the latter prophets are later than the first prophets. I, to this day, don't know where that term comes from, what the source for it is. I'll find it one day. It's not Jewish, that's for sure. As it turns out, 12 out of the 15 so-called latter prophets all took place during the time of the Book of Kings and earlier. So there are many things that you'll find in the Book of Kings. For example, I'm just taking an example, it happened after the so-called latter prophets. The latter prophets, what is called the latter prophets, is actually a different type of prophecy, in that these are called what are called oracular prophets, meaning that Isaiah was basically giving, teaching and speaking versus what are called the sort of the popular dynamic prophets like Joshua and others like him. So the term latter prophets does not have a Jewish source to it. It appears that the Jews at some stage, and it couldn't have been too long ago, adopted this term, but really it's not an, it is completely misleading.
I think the way that I heard it, and many people out there, many of the viewers have heard it too, is the greater and lesser prophets. And so from what I've understood from you and from others like David Solomon, there's nothing lesser about them. They're just, they just don't have as much volume in their message.
Right. That's what's called treyasa, or the 12 minor prophets. These terms, so a minor prophet, like let's say Zechariah, one might think that they're minor, which means like Hosea is not as important as Isaiah. Actually, Hosea, Amos, Micah lived at the same time. They were contemporaries. But the smaller books, the smaller works, some of them, you know, like Zechariah is only 14 chapters. You have Obadiah is only a single chapter. They were very small, so in physical size, not in their importance. And it's still the word of Hashem, so they are put together in the 12 prophets. So in addition to those 12, you have another three. And those three are the very large works of Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel. And those people lived in chronological order. Isaiah lived during a time of the Assyrian Empire. And what we'll do is we're going to take a look at what occurs and what happens and what brings about, why is it that Isaiah chapter 1 really does not begin with the first event in the book of Isaiah. And that is very important. Isaiah chapter 6 is very famous. Why? Because Isaiah 6 has in it the ecstatic vision of the heavenly vision of God sitting on the throne. We're going to get to all of it in a future show. Isaiah 6. The angels going, holy, holy, holy is his name. The earthquake. But that's when Isaiah is called to become a prophet. The question is, how is it that Isaiah chapter 1 really is much, much, much later, and it's put in as an introductory chapter, but it doesn't happen first? The question is, why? In order to answer that question, you have to know how to study prophets. So this show is not only an introduction to Isaiah, but it's an introduction to the prophets in general. That is that the prophets are, particularly this type of the oracular prophets, are answering an unasked question. They're answering a question, and unless you know what question Isaiah is answering, it can be very, very confusing. And that's, we can now take a peek at the opening passage of Isaiah. Much could be answered about why is Isaiah chapter 1, chapter 1? As I explained, the chronology is not the guiding principle here. There is another reason, and very importantly, it's vital that chapter 6 was not placed in the beginning of the book of Isaiah. That's very critical. So the question is, this is what I'd like you to do, you who are viewing the show. And that is, you need to ask yourself the question, in order to penetrate the book of Isaiah, in order to apprehend its opening chapter, in order to apprehend many of the chapters that will follow, is there is an implied question, there's a conundrum that needs to be answered, and Isaiah is answering that question. And if you don't know what the antecedent question is, which is not that difficult to figure out, but if you don't know what it is, it will seem, the text, the passages, will appear like a blur. Now, let's take a look at Isaiah chapter 1, verse 1. Now, Isaiah is going to tell us that he is speaking in the name of God, but he's telling us, just like, let's read it. Would you read it for me?
The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah.
Okay, this is very, very important. So, Isaiah, who is a prophet, the son of Amos, he has a vision from God. There are actually 10 different terms that are used in Scripture for prophecy. Chazon is one of those. Chazon means a vision, but this is a vision of prophecy of Isaiah. When we see the word chazon in the Bible, in Scripture, in the prophets, it means that there's very, very difficult, you're about to hear very, very harsh prophecy. Most famous, the term chazon, this term vision, which is unique, you'll find also in the beginning of the book of Ovadia, in Sefer Ovadia, the book of Obadiah. It's also exact same word, and Ovadia is about to give a prophetic message of the destruction of Edom. So once you see the word, the vision, Chazon Yeshayahu, so right away you know this is going to be clobbered. This chapter is so powerful and will shake you to your core and bring you to your knees. It's so earth-shattering, and it's very difficult to read. I'm warning you now that this is the Haftorah. That means that on Shabbat, not only do the Jews read from the five books of Moses, but we read select passages from the prophets. And this is what is chosen. This section, the first chapter of Isaiah, is selected to be read prior to the ninth day of Av, when we commemorate the destruction of the first and second temple and many other horrible events in history. And I'm wondering, when I say the word history, I just want to make a point to you, my brothers and sisters, listen very, very carefully, okay? If you ask a historian, why was the first temple destroyed? Ask any historian. They'll tell you right away, it's not complicated. They'll say, look, the Babylonian Empire merged following the Assyrian Empire, which we're in now. So the Babylonian Empire, they were very strong. Israel was a little vassal state. Judah, which was then just us, the southern kingdom, didn't comply, and Babylon showed its might and power and destroyed the first temple and exiled the Jews. Hey, it's a really straightforward answer. If you ask the historian why was the second temple destroyed, they'll say that the Jews were split into a whole variety of different groups, and the Romans ultimately came in to settle things, and then the Jews went to war with Rome, and Rome was the great Roman Empire. The Jews put up a good fight for 3 years, but from 66 to 70, by 70, after all, it's the Roman Empire. You know, this is not, you know, this is not Luxembourg, this is the empire. So ultimately, the Roman Empire was stronger and it destroyed the Second Temple and exiled the Jews from the land of Israel. They'll say Palestine. I don't know why these cycles still do this, but they do. I know why, but I'm not going to go into it. I'm not talking about those who are trying to, you know, honest historians, they use the word Palestine, but so that's what they'll say. If you ask the Jew, why was the First and Second Temple destroyed? We would say because of our sins. That's very critical. If you ask a Jew, why was the first temple destroyed? Because the Jewish people committed three cardinal sins and therefore was destroyed. Why was the Babylonian exile, did it last 7 years? We'll tell you it lasted 7 years, not because of really anything to do with Cyrus. It lasted 7 years, as we're told in Chronicles, that the Jews had also violated the laws of Shemitah, of letting the land lie fallow for 7 years. When we ask, yes, the Jewish people, why was the Second Temple destroyed? We wouldn't say because it was the Roman Empire. If you speak to the religious Jew, Arians has nothing to do with empires. The God of Israel, if God is on your side, nothing is impossible. No empire could bring you down. But the reason was because of baseless hatred that had filled the Jew. That's a very critical
point. You know, most Christians will say that the Second Temple was destroyed because of the death of Jesus, et cetera, et cetera. But as you pointed out plenty of times, their math is really, really off on that. I mean, by a number of years. Even if you really wanted to push that envelope of, you know, of idol worship or forsaking Jesus, if anything, it seemed like maybe the Second Temple could have been destroyed, maybe because there were Jews who were falling under this Jesus thing, you know, and that's why, you know.
No, it's interesting. That means what you're saying is that there are Christians that say that, you know, why the Second Temple was destroyed because the Jews didn't believe in Jesus. So actually, as you pointed out, the math doesn't work there, because according to Christians believe that Jesus was crucified around the year, let's say around the year 30. It had to have happened, according to the Christian Bible, during the authority of Pontius Pilate and Octavius, means Caesar Augustus. So the temple wasn't destroyed then. It was destroyed 40 years later. So therefore, it doesn't work. But not only doesn't that work, the problem is much more severe than that. The function of the Messiah, Scripture tells us, is he will usher in an epoch, a period, that certain events will unfold. Very specifically, a temple will be built. You can see that at the end of Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel 37, 24 and 25, we're introduced to the Messiah. Actually, we were introduced to him back earlier in chapter 34. We're actually discussing the Messiah. All Christians agree, 24 and 25, my prince David, he will be a prince over them. That's the Mashiach, right? And what are the next two verses, 27 and 28? The building of the temple, the Beis HaMikdash. Unless you say his body is his temple, it's nonsense. If you go to chapter 40, all the way through 48, really, or 47 of Ezekiel, what do you have there? The description of the building of the third temple, what it looks like, the dimensions of it, how many windows, what size is it, how tall is it, it's all there. So therefore, therefore the destruction of the temple is a demonstration that the Messiah had not yet come. That means to say the temple was destroyed because Jesus is the Messiah is preposterous. It's not just blasphemy, but it's foolish.
Right.
The function of Mashiach is not to destroy temples. The function of Mashiach is that the temple will be built, not destroyed. So it's like, you see, turning things on its head.
You know, see,
yes,
that brings up another thing. I mean, if the whole purpose of the coming of Mashiach is to rebuild the temple, and whenever he came, the temple was already standing.
Yes, the timing isn't so good. That means the purpose is very good. You're going to get a raise. Just remind me, we're really good. So that's another point. That means if the Mashiach is rebuilding a destroyed temple, so what would the Messiah do in coming while the temple's standing? And don't tell me Daniel 9, because you don't understand Daniel 9. And I go to my website, outreachjudaism.org, outreachjudaism.org. It don't cost you a penny. You can download my audio program on the book of Daniel. I'm not going to go into it now. It's not germane to this. I'll do this just for the fun of it. So the church really struggled for how do they explain the point that Jesus didn't die. The temple wasn't destroyed when Jesus was crucified. It kept going. How do they explain? This is a big problem, because all the church fathers said, I don't care, the Anti-Nicene church father, Jerome, much, much later in the 5th century, they all said this point, that God destroyed the temple and exiled the Jews, which again, Messiah is supposed to gather in the Jews, not exile the Jews, because the Jews rejected Jesus. So the problem for them was it doesn't work out at all. The key is, let's take a look at this. Now, number one, at this time, during Isaiah's prophetic career, it was massive. It was a prophetic career, as we're going to see now, that lasted more than 80 years. And at the time, the Jewish nation was really two different kingdoms divided completely. Following the death of King Solomon, his son was quite foolish. There was a revolt. There was a rebellion. I'm not going to go into it here. We'll be dealing with it in another show. But the key point is there was a northern kingdom called the Kingdom of Israel. It broke away from the southern kingdom of Judah. The only tribes that remained loyal to the kingdom of Judah and the Davidic king was obviously their own tribe, Judah, part of the tribe of Benjamin, and the Levites remained part of the southern kingdom, and the northern kingdom was split and was thriving, but set to be destroyed in the north, set to be destroyed by Assyria. The Assyrian Empire would emerge, and this would explode, would emerge and come in to conquer this part of the world, the Fertile Crescent. They would go right through Aram, Syria, word Aramaic is there, Aram, and then come right down and swoop in on the Northern Kingdom. And this is going to be the challenges that are going to come up in a very famous chapter a little bit later from now. Now, if you look carefully, I want you to look at the kings you mentioned. So Isaiah, just so you know, was a prophet for the southern kingdom, as was Micah. Amos, who was a contemporary, he's a little bit older than Isaiah, but their lives overlapped, and Micah lived the same and Amos and Hosea both were a little bit older than Isaiah in terms of their age. They were prophesying in the northern kingdom, describing the imminent destruction of the northern kingdom. They had prophecies for the south, but primarily their function was to speak to the northern kingdom. The prophet Isaiah was there for the southern kingdom, to get them back with God, to straighten them out. He also is going to speak to the northern kingdom, but that's not his primary focus. And that's why immediately, if you look at the first passage of Isaiah, was it say there, Chazon Yeshao ben Omotz, Isaiah the son of Omotz. According to Jewish tradition, Isaiah was also of the Davidic household, and he was a direct descendant of Amaziah, another king. So Isaiah, this is what would explain why Isaiah is constantly interacting with the kings. He's right in the palace. He's himself of royal descent. And look at the kings that, so, and he's speaking to who? Take a look at the passage. He's speaking Al Yehuda v'Yishlaim, because he's speaking primarily to the southern kingdom, Yehuda. And this is very critical. Bimei, in the days of who? Now, Uzziyahu, okay? Next one is Yotham, following by Ahaz, and then Chizkiyahu. We're given four kings. I want to ask you a question, William. Of these four kings, Uzziyahu, who's also known as Azariah, same person, two names, Yotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, which of those four are you least familiar with?
For me, it would probably be Yotham, I think.
Exactly. You could ask this to 1,000 audiences, you'll get the same answer. Who's Yotham? I heard of... All right. So this is, you'll go, this is important. There's not one extra word. And this is, the key is, it's the reason we're going to be spending important time on this show, this particular show, is that every word here, every king here, is very critical to unlocking what is going on here. Do you know why most people have never heard of Yotham? Most people never heard of this king who ruled for 16 years, is that he's the only Davidic king that during his rule never did anything wrong. And the Bible attests to it, that he went directly straight in the way of God. He, therefore, no one heard of him. Now, it's in scripture, but you'd have to look very carefully to find him. He's there. You'll find him in the Bible, but you'd have to look very, very carefully to find him. There's very little ink spent on him. Why? Remember what I told you in the beginning of the show. What is the purpose of the Nevi'im, the prophets? The purpose is to tell us what we're doing wrong. Yotham doesn't do anything wrong during his reign. As a result of that, there's almost nothing discussed because the prophets are not interested in discussing what we did right. So it does also give, one of the things you could see clearly is a skewed view of history. Now, let's go back again to these, because these four kings, all it's telling us is, superficially, if we look at Isaiah 1:1, all it, we seem to be told superficially is that this is Isaiah's mandate. His calling was to speak to Judah, and Jerusalem is its center. And Jerusalem, whenever you hear Jerusalem, it's messianic, because Jerusalem comes to represent the land of Israel in the messianic age. And then we're given these four kings. Incidentally, if you open up the book of Hosea, who's a contemporary of Isaiah, remember what I told you, but he's in the north, same time, you'll see there that Hosea is mentioning the northern kings in his introduction. Isaiah doesn't. Why? Because Isaiah is primarily speaking to the south, not to the north, although he's alluding to the north is going to come up a lot, but they're not the center focus of this great prophetic work. But the key is, let's look at these four kings, and this is going to help us unlock the mystery of what is the first chapter doing here and what is going on, because there's a major question that every person, I think, asks when they learn about the book of Isaiah. The four kings are Uzziyahu. This is the first king. Uzziyahu ruled, as I told you, for 52 years. He was a great king. Let me tell you, this is Uzziyahu and his son Yotham, who I already told you was a righteous man. This period of 52 years, followed by 16 years, was glory days. These were great moments. This is the time when Uzziyahu, also called Azariah, liberated many parts of the land of Israel. We have a lot because of him. It was a very successful time. He made a big mistake in the 25th year of his reign, in that he brought incense when it was forbidden. We will discuss this in another show. And he became a leper at that time. And that is precisely when Isaiah began his prophetic career. Okay, so in fact, so Isaiah's prophetic career is already, the following 27 years, he was a leper living in a cemetery that they built him a home. And then you had followed by his son Yotham, who was righteous. So you have this fantastic period of time of of 68 years. This is called the silver era of Jewish history. So if the 80 years of David and Solomon, if we can refer to it as the golden age, okay, then this period of these two great men, and even though Uzziahu made a terrible mistake, there was a moment where his pride gripped him and he made an error. Even after he got leprosy, the people loved him very, very much. And he certainly, even in fact, when they moved him to a different house, the Jews said, "We want you to stay as king." They absolutely adored him. He was a great man, but he made one very important error in his life. But he was a very righteous man otherwise. The question then becomes obvious. You know about Ahaz. This is the grandson now, who also is going to rule for 16 years. Is Ahaz wicked or is he righteous? He is. Ahaz, very, very wicked. Ahaz is a complete psychopath. So Ahaz is such a psycho, he's so evil, he's so wicked. I can't even go into all of it now, again, we'll save for another time, but he forges an alliance with Assyria. He literally bolts closed the temple so people can't pray there. He copies a altar from Damascus and has an idolatrous altar built on the Temple Mount. I mean, just unbelievable. There's an obvious question here is what happened to him? What happened to Ahaz? If you had a father like Yotam, who the Bible tells us, I finished telling you, was faithful to God, who walked in the path of the righteous, and he had a grandfather who was a very, very special man, what happened to him? Did he lose his mind? This is going to unlock for us. This is going to lock for us the conundrum of that time of what Isaiah is addressing and why this chapter comes first. This is really once you understand this critical point, you'll be able to then understand what is going on in this first very difficult chapter. And I assure you, the next 14 passages are going to shock you to your core. But you need to understand, what is Isaiah addressing? How did Ahaz lose his way? How did his generation lose his way? What was the problem going on among the Jewish people that Isaiah would have to write such an oracle? This is the critical part of understanding the book of Isaiah. If you grasp this, then you could move ahead. If Yotam, his father, Ahaz's father, Uzziahu, righteous men. That means, superficially, if you look at the temple during this is the first temple period, everything was going great. Superficially, on the surface, it appeared that the offerings were taking place. You can imagine the great temple of Solomon standing on Mount Moriah, the temple was very, very striking because we call these mountains, but these mountains are no more than 1,000 meters. They're even less than that. So this massive temple standing, Mount Moriah, smoke billowing up to the heavens. Jews were bringing sacrifices. They were going on their what's called the Ola Regel, which means during their appointed times, during the holidays. Thousands and tens and hundreds of thousands of Jews were going up to the temple on the new moons. It was tremendous service. The Jews were very, very observant. All you saw then were completely observant, religious, Orthodox Jews, whatever you want to call them, who the temple was going on in its glory with major kings who were really fabulous personalities. And what happens? During this exact time, when everything is going good, the Jews are bringing sacrifices, they're keeping their new moons, they're keeping Shabbos, they're praying all their prayers 3 times a day, everything. They're raising their voice to God, they're raising their hands to God. What happens? In the middle of this, Germany rises up. Meaning, in the middle of it, we're doing all the rituals right. My father was amazing. My grandfather was amazing. The Assyrian Empire, that's why the geopolitical state at that time is critical to unlocking the Book of Isaiah. And that is that the major problem that people were having is how the heck did this ever happen? Well, why is this? We're keeping all these commandments, we're doing these things, and why is it that God would allow such a thing? And it's interesting, whereas Elisha and, let's take Elijah on that order, were doing miracles all the time. In the book of Isaiah, Isaiah's really not doing, miracles happen. Isaiah's not a miracle worker at all. He's a speaker, he's an orator, he's a teacher, he's one who's going to criticize prophet, he's going to speak what will happen, but he's not a miracle worker. Because the problem during the time of Isaiah, which remained with us to this moment, is Jews who think that you can keep the laws between you and God and ignore social justice, meaning ignore your fellow man, ignore your brother, ignore, most importantly, the weakest members of society, the widow, the orphan, the destitute. And this is what Amos is screaming about. But if you think that you can just do rituals and not care for those who are the weakest members of society, you are making a huge mistake. And this is why I've allowed all this to happen. And that's why destruction has occurred. And the first, you'll see now in this first chapter of Isaiah, we really are going to encounter massive destruction, because he's going to describe what happened already. But Isaiah is going to, for 15 verses, going to answer the question of why is this going so bad? We're praying all day. We eat kosher. You know, we're keeping our new moons. We're keeping all the appointed times. Our sacrifice is going up. And then God said, you think that'll help you? In fact, the text goes further. It's like a spouse that's unfaithful to you but brings you chocolates. It's not that the chocolates don't repair the marriage. They become disgusting. If you have a spouse that is disloyal to you, unfaithful to you, and they bring you a Hallmark card, the Hallmark card not only does not heal the relationship, it becomes disgusting and you don't want it. You don't want the chocolates, you don't want the flowers. And that's what Isaiah does here. And that, my friends, brings us to the whole picture of this chapter and really much of Isaiah. And now Isaiah will make sense. Isaiah is going to first, and I'm preparing you now, not the only, there are other brutal chapters like the Nevi'im of Jeremiah, but is going to rip the Jewish people apart. And he's going to tell them, look, I really would destroy you. I'm keeping a remnant. I will say that by the time you get to verse 15 of the first chapter, you really feel it's over. You might as well, I mean, you're done. And what happens in verse 15, that God says, this is disgusting, and we're going to go through this passage where Isaiah just says, I've destroyed you. He's clearly speaking about what's happened already in the north, what's happening in the south, going in the south. I thought Assyria wasn't able to harm the south. The kingdom of Judah survived Assyria. That's not true. Much of Judah was destroyed by Assyria. There was the great, great miracle we're going to encounter in Isaiah chapter 9, 36, 37, 38. 38, we're going to see that as we see in 2 Kings 18. We're going to see that, but the ravages of this time is going to be explained exactly why this has happened to you. It's happened to you, why? Because of how you've treated other people. But just when you think that God is done with you because you have been so disloyal, so unfaithful. And then Isaiah is going to define what specifically you did wrong. Isaiah is going to pick you up and he's going to tell you how you can turn this around or how you can mess up completely. And that's how the chapter ends. But the chapter is going to move. Isaiah is going to say, let's talk. Let us reason together. And he's going to tell us how to get rid of your sins. And no, it's not by blood sacrifices. It's not by any kind of, but really it is by turning around and taking care of social justice. And then your sins that are as red as scarlet will be as white as snow. That's the key message. And that's powerful. And then the end of it, it's going to say, if you choose alternate B, it's going to be very, very bad. So Isaiah says, here are your choices. But I warn you, when you're reading Isaiah chapter 1, especially from verse 3 through 15, you're going to feel just ripped apart. It is one of the, and Isaiah was one of the great writers of the Bible. I mean, his writing is just shocking. I mean, when Dr. King, Dr. Martin Luther King in his speech. I mean, he's quoting a lot from Isaiah can write like no one can write. So when Isaiah writes, you're just like, wow, you're just pounding there. But here's what's going to shock you, my friends. This is why Isaiah 6 does not, which is the first chronologically, the consensus is, actually occurs first. The reason why isn't chapter 6 first? Why aren't we introduced with chapter 6? If I've told you chronologically, that's when God calls Isaiah to be a prophet, or Isaiah sort of volunteers to be a prophet after God calls. The answer is, listen very carefully, Kindlach. I'll go into more detail when we get to Isaiah 6. But Isaiah 6 is going to shock you, so I'm not going to explain this further, but I'll just share this with you. Right now, you'll be blown away by what you're about to hear. When God commissions Isaiah in the beginning of his prophetic career, God says to Isaiah, I don't want you to cause the Jews to repent. I don't want them to repent because they have to be punished. Imagine that? Most people, when we think of Isaiah 6, we think of this ecstatic vision of God on his throne. Again, we'll discuss then what is he doing on a throne with a long robe, but that's not germane. What is most germane is what people don't know about Isaiah 6. Most people know about holy, holy, and they have a picture of the angels going up. That is not what is germane here. If you read the end of chapter 6, after Isaiah, and this is very strange, we'll talk it, this is future shows down the line, Isaiah is told by God, I don't want the Jews to repent. They are now going to get it, and they're going to be punished. You cannot have the book of Isaiah begin that way. Now, why would God not want the Jews at that juncture to repent? It's not too difficult to figure out. If you gave your son the keys to the car, right? He turned 16, got his driver's license, and he gave him the keys to the car, and you found that later he drank and got pulled over for a DUI. You'd punish him, but maybe if your son would ask you, please, Dad, please, I'm sorry, I made a terrible, terrible mistake, you eventually would forgive him. Might, I don't know. You might, probably would eventually. Give him the keys again. And again, he drinks a six-pack, and he crashes into a tree. And then again, he pleads with you, I'm sorry, please forgive me, I'm sorry. And the third time, he hits somebody and kills somebody, drunk. What do you do at the third time? What is best for this kid at this point? What's best for this kid at this point is tough love. What's best for this kid is maybe he needs to go to jail for a while, and that's the only way he's going to realize the full force and the seriousness of what he's done. That's Isaiah 6. Isaiah 6 is, this is so horrible, perhaps our kid has to go to jail. Perhaps we got to stop hiring lawyers to figure out how to get him out of prison and eventually keep forgiving him, give him back the keys. He's got to actually go to prison. He's actually got to really get it. It's really not in his best interest for him to be sorry, and then give him back the keys again. Okay, that is very much Isaiah 6, but that is not what Isaiah wanted the book to be opened with, because naturally the key is the reason why on the pack of cigarettes in Indonesia, I don't know how it is in America, they have a picture of a lung that's cancerous, or they have a picture of a mouth that's cancerous, or a heart that's diseased on the side of a pack of cigarettes, is not because the government wants you to know what's going to happen to you, but the hope is that what? That you quit smoking when it says cigarettes kill, or whatever it says on the side of a pack of cigarettes. So the hope is that you would repent. And that's what happening here in Isaiah. And that's what's happening here in Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1 is the chapter to open up the book of Isaiah, because it really sets up the whole book. This theme is going to come up over and over and repeat itself again. Let's go to the next verse. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. Those words, for the Lord has spoken, I have reared children and brought them up, and they have rebelled against me. This language of Isaiah, listen, O heavens, that calling heaven and earth as witnesses should be very familiar to you. We see it, of course, the famous in Deuteronomy chapter 4, Deuteronomy chapter 32. Why heaven and earth as witnesses? Obviously, for two reasons. Number one, heaven and earth bear witness or testimony to the sins of the Jewish people and of man, in that if you do not listen to me, the heavens will not give forth their rain, and the earth will not give forth its harvest. So they bear witness, and uniquely the Jews, that the Jewish people are called upon in the Torah to be a priestly nation, a king of priests to the nations of the world, and that to be a light to the nations, that what the Jews do affect the whole world. Moreover, this really is very much a speaking to humans. Look at these words. I rear children. Bonim gidalti. I created children. What are people made of? Well, we are made of two things. There is no other creature in the world that's made up of heaven and earth. Remember, let us make man in our image. We are literally heaven and earth. That means we are divine, but that divine spark was infused into the earthly man, the earth of man, through the nostrils. So we are heaven and earth. This is very exquisite language, very powerful. I created you children, and you are heaven and earth. And heaven and earth are the witnesses, as we say in the Shema, and so on, as we see in the book of Deuteronomy. And then verse 3, look at this. The ox knows his owner. The donkey knows his master's trough. That means where the food is, the manger, where the owner keeps the food. And knows that when the owner calls, he follows them. Animals do a better job than you. You are a disaster. Animals, an ox, knows, you know, how to follow, but you don't. A donkey is different. It's interesting. A donkey is an animal that could be very stubborn and not necessarily will listen to its owner. But a donkey definitely is very interested in how it's going to get fed, where it's going to get its food from. It doesn't have to eat the best food in the world. In fact, it doesn't even need as good a food as a cow does. But a donkey certainly knows where his food is. So both these two animals are used very specifically because, look at you. I mean, these animals are loyal to their owner, or they at least be a donkey. If you're not a cow, that means if you're not just loyal to your master as a cow would be, as an ox would be, or how could you be so stupid? How could you have ignored my message? I've told you that the source of your sustenance is directly tied to your faithfulness to my message. So, I mean, you can't even do donkey. You not only can't do cow, you can't do donkey. That's what's very critical. That's what's going on here. You can't even... I've told you that you will be rewarded and you'll be given rain, you'll be given harvest. A donkey knows where the food is, and you don't know me. And now we're going through, now I'm just saying, if you're sitting down, I'm just going to go through this here, these very critical passages, but hold on to your chair, okay? Oh, you sinful nation, a people laden, filled in iniquity, you brood of evildoers, depraved children, or sinful children, or rebellious children, you have forsaken the Lord. You have turned your back on the Holy One of Israel. You've completely rebelled against the Lord. It's going to get more intense now. Why don't you realize what you're doing? Why do you seek further punishments? You continue to offend. You are sick. You are so sick that every part of you is sick. From the head to your foot, it's all bruises. And don't you know, and this is going to come up in Isaiah. Isaiah is going to later on talk about that repentance is very accessible. But why don't people repent? That will come up in weeks from now. Isaiah is going to address, if you can fix things correctly, why don't people do it? If God keeps his promise, and he does, why don't people take advantage? Why don't they even behave like a donkey? Forget it, like an ox, even a donkey. This is a shocker. So he says that you're completely demolished, you're pressed out, you don't even soften your wounds with oils. Not only that, now we're going to go from 7 to 10, through 7, all the way through, your land is waste. And Isaiah is speaking, you can see this is a chronologically later, because we are now looking back at the destruction of the northern kingdom, the shattering of the kingdom of Yehuda, the southern kingdom. As I said to you, Assyria had carried away more than 40 cities of Judah, including Lachish, the major city, destroyed. Only a tiny minority was left over, and that's Jerusalem. That's a great miracle we're going to encounter. Your land is laid waste. Your cities are burnt down. Before your eyes, look at what's happening here. I'm just going to go look at the harsh words here. Verse 9, had not the Lord of hosts left some survivors? You see, this is much, much later, because this text is looking back and is speaking back to something that's happened later. The actual destruction of Judah, with the exception of Jerusalem is saved, happens in the 14th year of Hezekiah, very late. You see how out of order this is. Look at this. Hear the word of the Lord, you leaders, you chieftains of Sodom. Give ear to the instruction, you folks of Gomorrah. I mean, he's literally calling them, these are the most... these are the cities that are the most sinful in history that got utterly destroyed. He said here, I can't do to you what I did to them. A remnant is going to be left over, and the Jews know what they're talking about. This is unbelievable. Now we're going to see what I've shared with you. The Jews are bringing sacrifices. They're going to the synagogues. They're praying. But the social justice. Watch this in verse 11. If you want to read it, you can, William. Go to verse 11.
Verse 11. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough of your burnt offerings of rams and of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and the lambs, and lambs and goats.
The key point is, now what is going to come to light is what I've shared with you. And that is, Isaiah is not going to tell the Jews, the problem is that you're not keeping kosher or you're not bringing sacrifice. You're doing those things. But there's another problem, and you're going to see it right here. So first he's saying, I don't need your stinking rituals, and I'm going to see that in a moment. Go ahead.
Verse 12, when you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you?
Who needs this? Yeah. You're trampling all over my temples. Who needs it? Jeremiah is going to have a speech that's nearly going to get him killed, where he says something very similar in Jeremiah chapter 7. But continue.
Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moon Sabbaths and convocations, I cannot bear your evil assemblies. Your new moon festivals and your appointed feast, my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Encourage the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless.
So here you see it, that what I've introduced to you, this is why I took up more time, because this is the introduction to our show on the prophets, is that here we see here the problem. Isaiah is saying, you're doing the rituals. You're checking and making sure it's glatt kosher. Now, people might go, well, Isaiah doesn't care about kosher and Shabbos. Nothing would be further from the truth. But the rituals have to be pregnant, have to be filled with meaning. And if you're ignoring the needs of the widow, of the destitute, they're disgusting to me. That's the key message over here. And Isaiah then says this beautiful verse here. He says, come, let's reason together. Now, that's got to shoot you back like, 50 feet. Come, let's reason together. You just told me I'm Sodom and Amorah. And this is very much Yeshaya. It's a smash where you literally just go flying right through the sheetrock. Isaiah picks you up and gives you a kiss. He says, there's a way out of this. Let's talk. You want to talk to me? You really? But I'm worthless. I mean, really, if you read these chapters through verse 15, 3 through 15, you get on, if you're not on the floor crying, shaking, there's something wrong with you. When I did the show, I prepared you 20 times. Isaiah, incidentally, just his style is, he pounds relentlessly. We will see this. Isaiah doesn't let it go. There is a lot of repetition. We'll explain why. There are times in Isaiah where he'll repeat the same message. The highest number is 24 times. Just pound it and pound it and pound it, you idiots. You missed it completely. Sure, there were sacrifices going on when Daddy and Granddaddy were going on. But you lost faith because you say, what good did it all do? Look, the Assyrian Empire is coming in. That's why the kings are so important. You fool! The reason, the problem wasn't that you weren't bringing offerings, you weren't bringing sacrifice, you fool. You had abandoned the weakest members of society, the destitute, the orphans, the widow. And then this is so sweet. He says, come, let's talk. Now, the key point here is that, what does Isaiah say? We are told this show is about Isaiah. It's not, we're going to bring up where the church comes in. This is very critical. In Christian theology, they would tell us, you need the blood, that's going to save you. And it says, idiots, that's not going to do it for you. It's not that there aren't many commandments associated with sacrifice. In fact, of the 613 commandments, About 130 of them are connected to sacrifices. But the mistake, you can remember, the purpose of the prophets is, the Nevi'im is, to make sure you get it straight what your priority is. Yes, the sacrifices are very important, but only if there's obedience. Let's talk together. Come, let us reason together. There is a way out of the problem, and the way out is not Calvary. There's not an innocent person that can die for your sin. Forget that. But there is a way that although your sins are as red as scarlet, I can make them as white as snow. They can be like fleece instead of like red, because your hands are full of blood. That's the key. So Isaiah is saying here, Kindlech, children who I have raised. The way to repair the problem here is not bring me more sacrifices. Because if you bring me another stinking sacrifice that stinks, because it is not, there's nothing there, there's nothing beneath it, there's no connection to me. And how do I know? Because the Torah says, Kedoshim tihiyu ki kodosh ani Hashem Elokecha. The way to be upright is to be like a God. Mahurachum afatorachum. Just as God performs acts of kindliness and He opens his hands and he gives, Psalm 145, to every needy being, you must do the same. And you've abandoned that. You've abandoned that whole mandate to be holy. And how is that? That you did not imitate God in his kindliness. And that's what's going over here. So what happens here in chapter one is there are two ways. There are two ways in front of you. Now, either way, there's going to be a remnant left over. The Jews can't disappear. I will leave over a remnant. It's going to come up later on again. We see, of course, at the end of Leviticus chapter 26. But this is one way. If you want to make it straight, the way you make it straight is you need to start taking care of the poor, the widow, the orphan. You need to take care of the neediest members of society. Stop hurting people. Alternatively, the chapter, of course, continues and goes, if you turn in the other direction, and instead of this, you continue in your ways, then you are facing almost complete destruction. And that's what Isaiah, this is the key of the book of Isaiah. Isaiah is saying, you don't get it. Yeah, I know, you had all those years of Uzziahu, Azariah, Yotam, great years. Yotam was a great king, but you thought it was okay. You didn't put your faith in me because you thought, how did the Assyrian Empire emerge? I'll tell you why, how this all happened. I'll tell you why all this destruction occurred. Yeah, your temple was churning out the sacrifices. You were praying, you were doing your prayers, but it did not in any way reflect how you behave towards people weaker than you. But Isaiah has a promise, and that promise is, come back to me. Return to me. How? By taking care of the needy, as I do. And if you do that, I will take all of your sins, which are red. I'll make it as well. I will cleanse you. And that's why this is the opening chapter of Isaiah. Now you understand it, because this is how to turn back to God.
אדון עולם אשר מלך בטרם כל יציר נברא לעת נעשה בחפצו כל